Coming up, Nikolai Volkov and his manager, the Doctor of Style, the Strixer. Gentlemen, I understand that we have some big news.
That's right, Blood. You know, everybody knows by now why I'm here. Everybody knows that Bam Bam Bigelow turned all those other managers down. And you know, because he knows that the Strixer is the greatest manager in professional wrestling today. He knows of my financial status. He knows of my mental abilities. And that's why at this time, I'm going to introduce my latest and my greatest acquisition, Bam Bam, and he's mine, mine, all mine. Yeah.
Where is he? Bam Bam, look at that. That's not, that's Humperdinck. What's he doing out here? What is Oliver Humperdinck doing out here?
Wait, what you doing out here, dude?
I'm here to introduce Bam Bam Bigelow.
What? Wait a minute. That isn't the intelligence report that I got. Take a look at that. That is an impressive
Bam Bam is making his
monster.
Perhaps he can tell us what is happening.
Bam.
What's happening, my man? What's happening, my man? Give me five, baby. Give me five, baby. Blood?
Let me tell you something, man. You are not my manager. Never be my manager if you were the last sidebar on the face of the earth, man!
What are you talking about, baby? We got it all figured out. What's the deal?
You and your commie friend better get out of my face now! Hey. Who you think you are, you ugly American? I can take you any time, any place!
Oh, yeah?
Yeah!
How about that?
Hey!
Goodness!
Here's my manager! Here's my manager, Oliver Humperdinck!
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Bam! Bam! Bigelow!
Bam! Bam! Bigelow! We'll be right back!
When I returned to the World Wrestling Federation, I anticipated lumps and bumps, and a lot of bruises, and a lot of pain, a lot of agony. But I'm going to tell you, Bobby the Brain Heenan, and the rest of your goon squad, I never anticipated a busted up arm that required a lot of surgery and a lot of time to heal. But I'm going to promise you one thing, I'll get even.
Who do you think you are, Orndorff? Who do you think you are firing me like that, trying to embarrass me? What I've done for you? Well, let me tell you something. Get a look at this man. Look at this body. No, on second thought, don't show him nothing. Because I want you to remember something. If it's not this man that takes care of you, it'll be one member of the Bobby Heenan family. You know, if a terrorist got out of the hospital, there's always room for more.
Some of you didn't hear what I said last week when I said I was the greatest intercontinental heavyweight champion of all time. Some of the former champions are a little bit upset, I understand. Namely, Macho Man Randy Savage. Well, let me tell you this, Macho Man. You can't wrestle as good as I can, and you can't sing, and you sure can't dance like
up, Bobby Heenan and the rest of the Weasel family. You tried to destroy my arm. Well, you did a pretty good job. The doctors had to drill a hole and reattach the tricep tendon. You tried to end my career. Well, it almost happened. The doctors don't know when it's going to be healed. I'm not exactly sure when I'm going to be back. But you didn't end my career. But I'm going to promise you one thing, Bobby the Brain Heenan and the rest of your Weasel family. I'm going to rid the World Wrestling Federation of all of you, one by one.
The vendetta is not over. In fact, it's just beginning.
Yeah, I told you I wasn't done with him yet.
This bout is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, the individual managed by the Doctor of Style, Slick. From Chicago, Illinois, weighing 450 pounds, the One Man Gang.
One Man Gang.
And his opponent from Goodyear, Arizona, weighing 247 pounds, Billy Anderson.
Billy Anderson giving away some 200 pounds plus here to the one-man gang and the Slickster. Slickster really surprised me, Brain, on the Pile Driver album. I didn't know he had
on it.
I don't know he had that kind of musical ability.
You know, talented man.
Jive Soul Bro is his cut on that
didn't
album.
Didn't Kate Smith used to sing that?
No, she never sang that. What is wrong with you?
Well, you know, I like the way Patera whines and cries. So he paid his debt to society, but he hasn't paid it to me yet.
Well, you haven't paid your debt either.
Well,
he's
still
not
got
through
a,
with you and the rest of your family.
He's still got another arm and two legs and a neck.
Well, you know, on that cut, the Jive Soul Bro, he talks and sings about having a date with some seven-foot lady who slaps a figure four leg lock on him. Do you believe that?
Probably.
Yeah, well, what surprised
me. Hum a few bars for me.
Well, nothing would surprise me when it comes to the Slickster. This guy right here, the one-man gang, now on a 30-day suspension, or not a suspension, but probation period. But we have some special words from President Jack Tunney about that.
The 30-day probationary period of the one-man gang is now over. Therefore, he is restored to full privileges with the World Wrestling Federation.
Well, that was short and sweet. Well, probation is over, but I don't think for very long.
Well, it's his first offense.
What do you mean first
He shouldn't
offense?
Have even been on probation. He should have walked on it.
Are you kidding after what he did to the referee?
Well, maybe they asked for it, you know.
That's beside the point.
And they fined him 10 grand or 15 grand, something like that. Isn't that enough?
This guy can afford it. The guy with the white brim around his hat, he can afford it. I don't think we've seen the last probation on this guy here, or possibly even suspension, because this guy is very unorthodox and doesn't know when to stop.
Well, if he wants to become the heavyweight champion, he can't do it sitting at home. He's got to do it in the ring. He can't do it when he's on suspension.
No, but there's a proper way to do it.
Sure, you just go out and beat a man. Beat him, beat him, beat him.
Yeah, you don't go out there and try to maim somebody. The object is to win, not to maim someone.
Yeah, but if
like
it happens,
Bundy does.
If it happens, it happens, you know.
Bundy tried to maim that poor little midget.
Little Beaver.
Yeah.
He did, too.
Well.
Yeah, but nobody really cares about Little Beaver. You know that.
Please.
He's your friend.
Look out, one-man gang. Looks like he's about ready to wrap this youngster up. Oh, there it is. That front suplex.
Oh.
Driving the face and head down into the canvas. Mr. Anderson is kaput.
Wow.
They said 452 pounds. That's 500 pounds we're looking at.
Here is your winner, the one-man gang.
One-man gang chalking up an easy victory here this week. And the Slickster very happy about
Bobby the Brain Heenan.
The guy I did everything for, and Humperdinck. You want to hang around together, you can hang around together. Hey, I'm talking to you two. I'm talking to you. To ingrate everything I did for that man. He thinks he can stab me in the back, walk out on me, fire me, try to embarrass me. He's badly mistaken.
What about
right now? I want you people to show proper respect, because I'm going to bring out a gentleman out here, something you're probably not used to. So you show the proper respect. You give this man the proper respect, because this man deserves it, he's earned it, and he demands it. Ladies and gentlemen, get ready. I'm going to introduce you now to the eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant.
Getting mixed emotions here from this crowd. Thumbs down, in fact. Andre looking around, not too happy about it. He looks in great shape, though. Looks like he's taking off some weight. Certainly, oh, he's upset. He expected a rousing ovation here, and he didn't get it. Let's go back to Craig.
Andre, can you give him a word, will you?
Oh, Andre turned his back and walked away. He's headed back for the locker room. He's really upset.
I told you, you didn't show proper respect. And you better learn how to show proper respect. Because that's the biggest and the best athlete in sports today.
Strike Force. Now, I don't know if you're impressed or not. I'm certainly think that the team is fast. They're agile. And they're just the kind of a team everybody should worry about.
Hey.
What?
You're
what
in
are you
my
doing
chair,
here?
Number one. You're in my chair. Now you've knocked both chairs over.
What are you doing here?
What are you doing?
I'm running the show.
Yeah, I can see that.
It's not working out too
well, is it?
It's working out fine.
It is.
Somebody,
I'd like to apologize for being a little late today. I arranged for a special piece of
footage.
Chair's
broke.
About you, Brain. Sure, you destroyed the furniture.
Didn't break no furniture. You threw me off of it.
Reason I'm late, folks, I spent a little time putting together a little piece of footage that I want to show today that the Brain will not like. What have you been doing since I've been gone here the last
been handling
minutes?
The show.
Yeah, I understand. You've got everybody upset here in the studio and everything. You've got all the personnel ready to bail out. You just get in your chair over there where you belong. That chair over there.
4-1 fall. Introducing first in the corner to my right from Kansas City. Weighing 248 pounds, Ace Cowboy Bob Orton. His opponent from New Haven, Connecticut, weighing 236 pounds, Jerry Allen.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to this World Wrestling Federation event. I'm Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside, and it gives me great pleasure at this particular point in time to introduce you
but
to a
I'd
very...
like to know
well, let's hear what the ace has to say.
Where is that dirty, yellow, no good, fat Hawaiian Don Morocco, seriously, the beach bomb? Get out of my face, boy.
Give me a break. As I was about to say, I'm going to be joined
this is
here
more
by
of a man than Don Morocco is.
Position.
At least he's out here to take his whipping. You're better looking than Morocco, too. He's an ugly, fat Hawaiian.
Right, maybe he'd like to be a broadcaster.
Morocco,
like
you're yellow.
Oh, they're on their feet here as one. The magnificent one is making his way down
Tubby
to the ring. Look at him, he's bent out of shape.
Come and get it, Tubby. Come on, baby. Come on, baby.
Look at the look on Morocco's kisser. Well, we may have an additional match here. Morocco not scheduled to make an appearance. Got several referees out there trying to hold him back. He's like a bad dog, Mike.
It seems that Jerry Allen might have to wait for his turn at Cowboy Bob tonight.
Well, the divorce is final. Complete split between Morocco and Orton.
There's no question, Gorilla, who the fans want to see tonight.
Oh, look at this. Laying right down on the platform here. Oh, look at, they want at each other in the worst way. The referee holding back Orton and another referee holding back the magnificent one. In fact, two of them, three of them out there.
Really? Yeah.
Dave Hebner, one of the premier referees here in the World Wrestling Federation, exerting the magnificent one to get back, and this match is underway right now. Whoa! Jerry Allen to the outside quickly, going up all the way to the top. Look out, Orton wide open.
He set himself up for that, Gorilla.
He certainly did. Mike, I'm sure when I introduced you that the fans out there don't have a clue, don't realize you are one of the loveliest broadcast colleagues I've ever seen.
Thank you so much, Gorilla, for that nice compliment. I'm glad to be here, especially with you.
Well, thank you very much. Mason, I was going to do some commentary with Mike McGurk. Of course, Leroy McGurk is a great name that's gone down in the annals of wrestling history. And I didn't have a clue that... Well, how did you get the name, Mike?
Well, most people think the same thing. You're looking at a girl here that's supposed to have been a boy.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And that has followed me around all my life. I've had fun with it, though, girl. Thanks.
I'm sure you have. Orton taking a little Heitske for himself. Match not going to his liking. I'm sure that the ace, who is a consummate wrestler in his own right,
He had his game plan sort of shook up a little bit when he came out there. He was obviously all set for Jerry Allen, then got thinking about the Magnificent One and what's gone down between those two. And incidentally, Mike, I don't know whether you know, I certainly don't know, who got custody of Mr. Fuji when a divorce took place.
I don't know. I think he's up for adoption right now.
Well, gut-wrench suplex by the ace, who can do it all inside that squared circle.
Feeling a little confident right now.
Second-generation wrestler and probably the greatest mechanic that I know inside that squared circle. Of course, Jerry Allen, no stranger to the ring. Oh, look at that. Drove him face first down right into the canvas. Of course, the Cowboy has put away a lot of guys and literally sealed a casket on a lot of careers with that patented move of his off that top turnbuckle.
He certainly has.
That superplex. I'm sure you're familiar with that, Mike. We've seen it so many times.
Yes, but not personally, thank goodness.
Oh, well, you might see it here. Double underhook. Oh, turned him loose, almost dropped him on his head. Double underhook from the backside, meant to be a suplex. Ace is meant to go with that move. At the same time, he chose not to, which makes it 10 times more dangerous. Well, he's going to take out all the frustration, obviously, on Jerry Allen that he wanted to take out on Magnificent One.
Absolutely.
Going to work on that back area, softening it up. Another capacity crowd on hand. To the outside, through the second rope, whenever the World Wrestling Federation invades, it's the hottest ticket in town.
And you can hear their reaction, Gorilla.
Certainly can. The ace having a good time right now, however, unfortunately, at the expense of Jerry Allen. I don't know, it won't be too far down the road, Mike. I'm sure that we're gonna see on paper and inside that squared circle eventually the matchup between Morocco and Orton.
Absolutely. The two have no love lost for each other. It's sad to see their divorce come down like this, but there is something to be met later on down the line.
Well, you know, these two guys, in their own right, the Magnificent One, of course, former Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion, took it away from Pedro Morales right in Madison Square Garden in the center of the ring, and it takes a heck of a man to do that. And, of course, this guy here who... You just can't say enough about his ability. There's no telling how far that team could have gone. Look at this. Oh, rams the right shoulder and the right kidney area right into the steel post.
Really, he's really going too far with Allen tonight, this week, it seems.
Well, he's making him pay. He's making him pay for what he wanted to do to Morocco and didn't get the opportunity to do it. Look out.
And
either power slam or shoulder breaker coming up.
Yep. He's taking advantage of the situation.
Certainly is. Power slam. That's enough to put anybody away right there. He doesn't want it, though.
No.
He's not done torturing the youngster. Drags him over towards the corner. Obviously, going to have the ropes come into play here in one shape or form or another. Going all the way to the top? Yes.
Apparently, he's hoping that Morocco's watching this.
Well, I'm sure he is. Bombs away. Oh, he waited too long. Jerry Allen caught him on the way down, brought those knees up. Wasted a little bit too much time up there, huh?
I thought Allen was gone. I thought he had already been put away.
Oh, Allen now making a mistake. Oh, look at this. He's got him set up perfectly for that superplex. He's got it up there. So long, Jerry. Turn on the hot water. This one's over.
That's it.
Cowboy Bob Orton, believe me, he could do it all.
It's Cowboy Bob Orton.
Very impressive victory for the Cowboy, but just a big round of boos. Let's go back and take a look, Mike, at how the youngster made a mistake and it literally cost him the match.
Here we go. He's in the corner.
Once he gets you right there, Mike, in that position, there is no escape.
No. He had no alternative except to go.
It's too late at that particular point in time right there. Object is to stop that before he slaps it on. Plenty more action, still to come.
Ladies and gentlemen, this contest is scheduled for one fall. In the ring to my left, introducing the manager, the Doctor of Style, Slick. He represents from the Soviet Union, weighing 313 pounds, Nikolai Volkov. Boy, this is going to be some matchup. Ladies and gentlemen, at the request of the Doctor of Style and Mr. Volkov, they ask that you please rise and allow Mr. Volkov to sing the Soviet National Anthem.
Why don't you sit down, Jesse, for crying out loud? What's the matter with you?
Thank goodness that's over.
Your King Omega, the Flash!
His opponent, led towards the ring by his manager, Oliver Humperdinck, from Asbury Park, New Jersey, weighing 393 pounds.
Wow!
Bam! Bam! Bigelow!
What an ovation! But Bam! Bam! Russian goes down. He's up. Bam Bam with another hard right, and Volkov on the outside. Bam Bam. Look at that maneuver.
Boy, a cartwheel of 393 pounds. That's agility.
What agility on the part of Bam Bam. Volkov attacking from behind before the bell had actually rung. Volkov did a run. Ooh, shoulder block. Nothing happens. You've got to be impressed thus far.
I'm just watching right now. I never talk until I get an impression.
Look at that. Another shoulder block by Bam Bam. 393 pounds, and Slick is beside himself. Bam Bam to the rope. Oh, ha, ha.
Hey, I'll tell you, I'm impressed with Bam Bam, but I think he made a grave mistake going with this Humperdinck. Instead, he could have had Slick.
Bam Bam just hammering away on the big Russian. Uh-oh. Look at that. The Bam Bam coming right back on him. Bam Bam now. Back on. And Volkov goes down. Elbow. And down goes Volkov again.
Look at that little ugly red-headed troll outside the ring. Slickster's upset. I don't blame him.
I don't blame him either. Volkov not doing all that well at the moment against Bam Bam Bigelow.
For a 393-pounder, he's got amazing agility and speed. That I'm really impressed.
The only thing, I think he needs a few more tattoos.
I don't think so. Big Nikolai with a kick to the midsection now. Working downstairs, Bam Bam comes right back at you.
You think this big, ugly Bam Bam, I bet in the middle of his chest he's got mom. Can you imagine?
I don't know what he has. Whoa. I do know this. He has lots of ability. Slick is stunned. Slick is actually stunned. Bam Bam. Standing drop kick. Walk off again. Over the top rope.
Well, that's pretty amazing to see a guy of his size able to get up and do a standing drop kick. I am impressed with that.
Look how high he got with that drop.
But he sure is ugly.
I don't think this is a beauty contest, Jesse.
Well, you always seem to make it one when Elizabeth comes around.
That's different.
Oh, that's different.
Nikolai back in the ring. Two big bulls in there. Volkov and Bam Bam. Bam Bam with a right hand. This big Russian Volkov is staggered. Don't count him out. Listen, this capacity crowd shooting for Bam Bam. Bam Bam with another headbutt.
And Nikolai Volkov making a smart move. Slid out to the ring, slid out to the floor. He's got to get with the Slickster and get it together.
Bam Bam waiting patiently. Volkov coming into the ring, looking on, of course.
Oliver Humperdinck, the manager of Bam Bam, and the manager as well of Mr. Wonderful Paul Wonderful. Look at the big Russian comeback.
Now we'll see if Bam Bam can take it. We know he can dish it out. Let's see if he can take it.
Oh. Bam Bam to the outside. Bam Bam, what's he doing? I think he's going to go after Slick. Slick, did you see how fast he ran? Huh?
Here is your winner, Bam Bam Bigelow.
A standing ovation for Bam Bam Bigelow. They're being congratulated by his manager, Oliver Humperdinck.
Well, man, 393 pounds. He shows tremendous agility, as we just saw over here. Now, look at here. He grabs a punch with a headbutt on Volkov and knocking him out and pinning him. But just a lot of quickness for a man, 393 pounds. That is truly amazing.
Bam Bam Bigelow. I think we'll be seeing a great deal more of Big Bam Bam. Let's take you now to Craig DeJarge.
Ladies and gentlemen, the question is, do you have a price? Well, my next guest has been claiming you do. Introducing the million-dollar man, Ted DiBiase. Ted, I want to...
You've said enough. Well, Virgil. Here we are in the fruit-picking capital of the country. And as you all know, you don't make very much money picking fruit. And it's obvious as I look around this building tonight that we're in the midst of a very poor, poor crowd. And as you all already know, just like you're poor, I am very, very rich. That's right. I am loaded. And you know what that means? I'm rich, you're poor, and that makes me better than each and every one of you. And you know something else? It doesn't matter whether you're young or old. All you kids out there are just like your parents. You know, father like son, mother like daughter. You've all got a price for the million-dollar man, too, and I'm going to prove it right here, right now, because I'm going to give some young person out there the opportunity to make some money from the million-dollar man. That's right. I want somebody to do some push-ups. Now, who wants to do some push-ups for the million-dollar man? Let me see the hands, all you kids out there who want to do some push-ups for the million-dollar man. Well, look at all those hands, Virgil. Okay, right over here. Right there. That's it. Bring him up here. Right up here. That's it. You want to make some money from the million-dollar man?
Yes.
You can do some push-ups for me? All right, get down there. Let me see how many push-ups you can do. Four. Eight push-ups, not too bad. Well, I tell you what I'm going to do, kid. I'm going to give you No, Virgil, I'll tell you what. I'll give you $300, kid, and you look like you could use $300. I bet you and your parents both could use $300. I'll give you $300 if you can get down there and give me 10 push-ups. Now get down there and give me 10 push-ups. 1, 2. Thank you. the 10 now, did we? And we gave it a real good try, didn't we?
I did my best.
He did his best. But he didn't get the 10. He didn't get the 10. What do you think, Virgil? Did he earn the $300? You know what, Virgil? I'm going to have to agree with you, because you see, kid, doing your best just ain't good enough for the million-dollar man. You don't get the money. You know what else? You're just like all of these other people in this crowd. As well as being poor, you're all a bunch of suckers.
Reports are that Andre has been lifting heavily. Andre there, shaking hands with Ravishing Rick Rude on the outside of the ring, along with, what an entourage. Bundy's out there. Hercules is out there.
What we need to have right now is for all the fat, funky, corn-fed men in here to keep their noise down while I take my robe off so your ladies can adore my simply ravishing body.
Well, there's one that's going to adore it.
That's Bruno's girlfriend, ain't it?
I beg your pardon.
Look at her mouth is watering. Look at the build on Ravishing Rick Rude.
He's put together.
I mean, this guy's ripped. Look at the abdominals on him.
Monty and Rick Rude. As Monty goes right on up and right back down. Look at the physique of Ravishing Rick Rude. Can you imagine Andre the Giant out at ringside if you're Jerry Monty? Sure, you've got to worry about Ravishing. Oh, what is this? Is it over?
Look at that.
That's it.
You've got to be kidding me.
I love it. You notice now you don't see no Ken Patera coming around.
Well, that's
you don't see no Paul Orndorff coming around.
Here is your winner, Ravishing Rick Rude. I don't think anybody's going to be around as long as Andre is around. Andre the Giant, the eighth wonder of the world, the biggest and indeed the head of the Heenan family. Look at that entourage. That is impressive. Right now, let's take you to Larry Klein, the producer of American Bandstand, with a comment on the wrestling album Piledriver.
Come on, Jimmy Hart. Where's the honky tonk? Right now!
What do you want to know? I don't know!
You got a message for me.
Okay.
It's Randy Savage. You understand that? You tell him to shut up. You tell him to shut up about me. You understand that?
I'll tell him.
Yeah, okay. You sit down.
I'll tell him.
You better shut him up.
I'll tell him.
Come on, hot dog.
Who does he think he is? I'll tell the Honky Tonk Man, you're going to be sorry. I promise you this. If Honky Tonk was here, you wouldn't do this to me, Randy Savage. I'll tell you that right now. He wouldn't do this to me. I'm telling you. Look at my glasses. Look at my glasses. Look at my outfit. Look at my outfit. You're going to be sorry.
Let me introduce you to my guest, manager of the South, Jimmy Hart, and the Honky Tonk Man. Gentlemen, I want to get to the bottom of a breaking story. Honky, you recently said you were the best Intercontinental Champion in history.
I said I was the greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time.
The greatest champion. Do you realize, according to some of my sources now, this has raised the ire of all the former champions?
Well, what they do, right, Honky?
In particular, I'm not sure if you two are aware, and this is really more than Miff, the former Intercontinental Champion. Those boastful comments, and I'm speaking of the Macho Man, Randy Savage.
Big! Big deal! Who cares what a former champion, Macho Man Randy Savage, has to say? My fans, the people want to hear from me, the Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion of the world. I'm the best. I'm the greatest. Besides, he can't sing, he can't dance, and he sure can't pick a guitar.
And plus, Honky, he's managed by a woman, too.
What does that have to
do with it? Let's get down to the business. Let's get down to the new wrestling album, Pile Driver. Who's got the number one hit single on the Pile Driver album?
Well,
the Honky Tonk Man does. And who's singing that song? I am. The Honky Tonk Man's got the number one single. And that's all she wrote. Thank you very much.
He's the greatest, baby, the Honky Tonk Man.
All right, thank you, Mouth of the South and the Honky Tonk Man.
They are one of the most powerful, most awesome tag teams ever to hit the World Wrestling Federation. Under the management of Mr. Fuji, they have been, well, unstoppable. Introducing Action Smash Demolition and manager Mr. Fuji. And gentlemen, I understand you've been very productive outside the ring as well.
You know, talking about hit records, everybody's buzzing, everybody's talking, and everybody's anticipating the new album, Pile Driver, that's coming out this Monday. And they should be, because on that album, there's a song by Rick Derringer, the number one rock star today, talking and singing about the number one tag team today, Axe and Smash Demolition. He sings about total destruction and pain. He sings about us. He sings how we do it in the ring.
Well, you guys are not only making records, but I guess have your eyes on setting some records.
That's right. You said it right. We're setting records because it doesn't matter where or who. With Mr. Fuji's devious mind, he has taught us well. He has taught us to search and destroy. And that's just what we do. It doesn't matter if it's the Hart Foundation or the Killer Bees or the Rougeos or anybody, because we're here for one reason. That's to demolish everybody.
This contest is scheduled for one fall. Approaching the ring from Stone Mountain, Georgia, weighing 249 pounds, Jake the Snake Roberts.
Jake the Snake Roberts. Why is he something else?
From Tampa, Florida, weighing 241 pounds, Terry Gibbs.
Terry Gibbs to meet Jake the Snake Roberts. The bell rings and Gibbs already pointing over to the bag right away, Jesse. The psychological advantage is in favor of the Snake.
Oh, I'll agree with that. Look at that thing in there. Oh, that gives me the willies.
You afraid of snakes, Jess?
Not a bit.
Not much.
Not a bit.
I bet you're not afraid of anything, are you?
Well, I don't know. Nothing I can think of at the moment.
Yeah, I didn't think so. High hip toss by Jake the Snake. Ooh, nice knee lift by the Snake. Receiving in. Earlier on, we had an occasion to chat with Danny Davis. Apparently, he is objecting to the fact that Jake the Snake brings the bag to ringside.
As I said before, if Jack Tunney isn't going to do anything about that snake at ringside, then I'm going to do something about it.
What do you think he meant by that?
I'm not too sure, but I'll tell you what, you know, being, you know, Danny Davis, the competent referee he was, I'm sure he knows the ins and outs of plenty of situations. He may just do something about that snake. Jake may open up the bag someday and be surprised.
We'll find out with Danny Davis in it.
Well, look at that. I think maybe whatever's in the bag heard what Davis said. That bag, look at the bag, look.
Damien's trying to get out.
Slam by Terry Gibbs. To the rope, Terry Gibbs sets and drops, but nobody home. Uh-oh. Jake now. What a nice slam. Jake spins him around, scoops him up. Holds him up there. Slams him again. Seldom using the same hold twice.
No. Ouch, look what he's doing. Look what he's doing to that arm. He's got the wrist twisted back onto the mat, putting pressure on that elbow. I just wish for once, McMahon, for once you had been able to get in that ring so that you'd know the pain that they're suffering in there, and then you'd know what you're talking about. Bruno knows about a lot of pain because a lot of people put him through pain.
Well, Jess, I must say that...
You know, I would even come out of retirement to wrestle you, McMahon.
You what?
I would come out of retirement to get you in the ring.
Well, Jess,
don't speak too soon. You got a price, too.
I'll think about it.
Maybe I'll get the $1 million man to put up the money.
Look at that bag. Oof.
Look at that, huh? Davis trying to get out. Whoa, look at the Jake Roberts right now is in trouble.
That's Terry Gibbs. He'll give you a match and a half.
Definitely. Gibbs is a veteran. He looks in the best shape I've seen him in.
Very underrated wrestler, too. He has surprised many a wrestler.
That's why I give the snake credit. The snake doesn't duck anybody, even on television. To face a guy like Gibbs on TV, you put a winning streak on the line.
Jake the Snake with Terry Gibbs. Snaps him over now. Semblance of a sleeper hold by Jake.
He's not getting quite the leverage he wants to go for a sleeper in there.
Knocks him to the corner. Jake, look at that though, missing. Jake uses the entire ring, if you'll note. Some wrestlers, very prone to staying close to the ropes.
Ooh, and there's that short clothesline.
That'll ring your bell.
That sets up for the DDT.
It could, yes, here it comes. Look at that. Cover. And lights out of three. Wait a minute, what's happening? Danny Davis is on his way to the ring shot. Danny Davis just grabbed the bag. Davis has Damien. He's heading away.
I love it. He said he was going to do something about it.
Now we know what he meant. Oh, wait a minute.
He dropped it.
I don't blame him. Hot on his heels. Jake the Snake Roberts was hot on his heels.
Here is your winner, Jake the Snake Roberts.
Jake the Snake Roberts. Now we know what Danny Davis meant, how he was going to do something about it. And finally, out of the bag, Damien. Damien's been growing lately. Damien looks to be about, I don't know, 20 feet maybe?
Who knows?
Look at that. Oh, my goodness. If Terry Gibbs wakes up now. Oh, look at, I can't believe that. Ooh, that gives me the willies. Jake the Snake Roberts, victorious, will be back with more World Wrestling Federation action.
To us, if it's a big Russian Nikolai Volkov, or it doesn't matter if it's a one-man gang, they're all going to go down in time. And Bobby Heenan, any member of your family, any time, any place, brother. And I want everybody out there to remember one thing: when you play with fire,
listen up and listen up good, Macho Man. I know you're going to be here next week, and I am too. And I'm going to give you 10 good reasons why I'm the greatest Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion of all time.
If you don't want to be
be a champion like the Honky Tonk Man, and you don't want to be a world champion like the Hart Foundation. Don't worry, baby. You'll never be one. I'll see to that. We're going to give you a heart attack.
Ha, ha, ha. Bam, bam. You better look in back, because you get Khan, Damnation, Sika, Kamala going over you.
You know, Bam Bam, it's very simple. You either go with me or you go against me. You've made your first mistake, going against the Heenan family. That's a big mistake.
Bam! Bam! Brother! Son, you in trouble, because nobody turns down the Slickster.
It seems all the managers are on the... are mighty upset right now, and they're upset at me, and they're upset at this man right here. But I want everybody to remember, if when you said we're marked men, we're used to being marked men, it doesn't scare us. And I want you guys to remember one thing, and that's when you play with fire, you're gonna get burned.
This is a one-fall, eight-man tag team bout. Introducing first, the team accompanied by their manager, Bobby the Brain Heenan, at a combined weight of 1,148 pounds, the King Harley Race, Hercules, Ravishing Rick Rude, and King Kong Bundy. Their opponents, at a total weight of 929 pounds, Brady Boone, his tag team partners, Dusty Wolf, Rudy Ryder, and S.D. Jones.
Well, I don't like the chances of Wolf, Boone, Ryder, and Jones in this one.
Say, what we need right now is for all the out of shape, funky looking men in the building to keep the noise down while I take my robe off, so that the ladies can let their imaginations run wild.
Oh, does that include you and I, Luscious John, or what?
Well, I think you better be quiet, Mr. Monsoon, and see what this man has to offer.
I know what
offer.
He looks like.
This man, look at that physique. Look at that physique on Ravishing Rick Rude, Bobby Heenan's latest claim to fame, his latest. Look at these women here. Look at the tattooed lady.
Yeah.
Do you think, what do you mean, yeah? You recognize her?
No, but it's...
she a former member of the Monsoon Fan Club at one time?
No, but I think that that particular kind of lady would get turned down by the Ravishing One.
I would certainly think so. I think she's been turned down by a drill press at one time, too, in her life. All right, here we go. Hercules Hernandez in there against...
Dusty Wolf.
Dusty Wolf.
Herc with that awesome power.
Oh, yes.
Of course, you know, the Heenan family short one member now, because just recently, Mr. Wonderful said sayonara.
I wonder why.
You wonder why?
Yeah, is there any reason behind that, or he
saw the light.
He saw the light of what? The silvery moon?
Well, he saw that the Brain was just a liar, that's all. It's a simple fact, the guy is a liar.
So.
I'll tell you, another huge member, the biggest member of the Heenan family, has a few choice words to give us all. So let's right now go to Andre the Giant.
Andre the Giant is very proud of the Bobby Heenan family.
Well, a man of few words. He's proud of the Heenan family.
Well, isn't that nice to hear, as we see Ravishing Rick Rude here with a tremendous slam at the hands of the, not the Red Rider, but Rudy Rider. Look at the physique on this Ravishing Rick Rude. And come to think of it, Mr. Monsoon, do you know that your protege here, Bobby the Brain Heenan, is on the... Your friend! Your friend! You guys are friends!
Colleague is the word.
Colleague out here! Your fellow announcing friend!
Don't get hyper now, Luscious.
He's on the cover of the magazine.
I know that.
The October issue, 1987.
He's dropped that into me, I realize
I've
that.
I've never seen you in there on the cover. Seen you on the back end. I've never seen you up and down the fairway of the book.
No,
I think that's
true.
A tremendous honor for Bobby the Brain Heenan, and there are many fans out there. In the October issue, you will see Bobby Brain Heenan on the cover.
Well, I congratulate him on making the cover of the magazine. However, there's still leaves a lot to be desired. Let me tell you that. I'm glad you toned down a little this week. Last week
I am very upset.
Last week you almost walked off the platform.
Listen, I had an airplane. It was so late that things still didn't come in. I am very upset with some of these airplanes. They're driving me berserk. Just like I am watching this Rick Rude manhandle Rudy Ryder.
Look out. The Ravishing One going to the top turnbuckle. SD Jones shouting to his partner.
Too
late. He nailed him.
Man, did he ever nail him.
Not for the cover. It could be all over. No.
No, not yet.
Well, I'll tell you what.
I want to tell you something. Doesn't this guy resemble a Burt Reynolds or a Tom Selleck to you?
Yeah,
really,
he reminds me of Selleck, yes. Not
Tom
Burt Reynolds.
Selleck,
yes.
Yeah.
Don't make
the guy Croatian. Tom Selleck. You know, the guy from the Hawaii deal over there?
I understand what you're talking about.
Now, how about the other guy here with the red T-shirt on? This Ryder. Who's he remind you of?
Doesn't remind me. He reminds me of a guy that's getting squashed like a grape right now.
Well, that's exactly true.
Look out. The big guy comes in. King Kong Bundy.
This, I'll tell you. The
fast food king.
I'll tell you, this heated family is awesome. Man.
Avalanche.
Oh!
Nailed him with it.
Man, hold the phone, Grandma.
Look at SD Jones, the look on his face. He knows it's all over.
He doesn't want that ring. I don't blame him. I wouldn't want that ring either. Oh.
Roundhouse right drops him right to the canvas.
You know the old expression, being beat with an ugly stick, I said would certainly apply right here.
Look out.
Oh. Man, man.
I believe it's over. He wants a 5 count. He could have a 55 count.
Exactly
it wouldn't make any difference. Once he drops that number on you, bye-bye, Charlie.
The winners of this bout, the team of King Kong Bundy, Ravishing Rick Rude, Hercules, and the King.
Very impressive victory. Right now, let's go to another colleague of mine, a Mr. Craig DeGeorge, along with the former Olympian, Ken Patel.
You see what's on my arm? You're all responsible. You're trying to destroy me. Well, I'm going to tell you, you're not going to get the job done. I've faced adversity before. I've been down and up before. But I'll come back, and I'll tell you something, boys. I'm going to run the World Wrestling Federation.
Of
all of you, one by one, you're all going to go down.
About you have just continued the pursuit and the diligence, and I speak for a lot of people saying we all admire you for that pursuit.
I'll tell you, I've been a winner all my life in amateur sports, collegiate, Olympic Games, Pan American Games, everything. The toughest thing I've ever done is professional wrestling. I've expected pitfalls and roadblocks, but I'll tell you, Weasel, you think you're going to get rid of Ken Patera? You're sadly mistaken. You can get me down for a while, but I'll guarantee you one thing. I'll always be back.
Ken, this is obviously the latest obstacle for you to overcome.
That's right. The doctors repaired it. They surgically attached the tricep tendon. But I'm going to tell you something. Every time I hit one of the Weasel family members, break their watermelon heads. You know what this is called? This cast is called the Weasel Whacker. That's right, Weasel Whacker. And remember, Weasel, you're going to get whacked, boy.
Well, I really can't agree with what the Honky Tonk Man says. Plus, I don't even like his style.
Scheduled for one fall. Soon to be making his way to the ring area, the King, Harley Race.
Again, everyone, Bruce Pritchard at ringside, along with Mike McGirt, here in Rockford, Illinois, at the Metro Center, as the King, Harley Race, makes his way into the ring.
And soon to be entering the ring area, his opponent, from Detroit, Michigan, weighing 288 pounds, George the Animal Steele.
Capacity crowd on hand here in Rockford, Illinois. Mike is the Animal. George Steele makes his way to the ring to battle the King.
No doubt who's there, who's the crowd's favorite here. And yes, he's ready.
Indeed, and the Animal now chasing the King outside of the ring. And the Animal is definitely a man to be feared inside that squared circle.
Feared, and every time he walks into the ring, he's on the borderline of suspension, Bruce. He's just right on a fine line of being suspended or just barely kept in the ring.
A tough and unorthodox competitor as the Animal goes to work on Harley Race in the corner as the referee stops the Animal, and the King going to work, taking full advantage. Harley Race now has the Animal. Looks as if he may be going for a pile driver. He has him up. And
good,
oh, pile driver.
That guy is strong to be picking up that man.
Harley Race, a wily ring veteran, knows the inside. He goes for the big headbutt, but misses.
Just in time. As the Animal is trying to regroup, he's got a headache. Number one.
The Animal, George Steele, also a ring veteran with a big clothesline, and he has the King wondering exactly where he is. And the Animal looks like maybe he's having some dinner on the Harley's Race's head, and Race over the top rope on the floor. The Animal now a little bit confused as the referee cautions him to stay in the ring. Harley Race now making his way back into the ring, and the Animal right after him.
Bruce, you know that Harley is a member of the so-called Heenan family, and you don't see him anywhere around, and I wonder why that is.
Well, Bobby the Brain Heenan, conspicuous by his absence, is Harley Race out on his own battling the Animal, George Steele, and not doing too well at this point, Mike.
No, and as far as the family, it doesn't look too close-knit.
And Harley Race now hanging from that top rope, and the Animal helped him on the way down. This capacity crowd here in Rockford really getting behind George the Animal Steele.
That's tarnishing the crown a little bit, wouldn't you think, Bruce?
Indeed, Harley Race shaking the cobwebs from his head, trying to get back in the ring, and the Animal that time introduces Harley to that hard ring post. Side headlock, and that time, Harley Race burst it through the Animal into the turnbuckle. Knee into the midsection by the King, and Harley Race now has the Animal on the ropes as the referee cautioning Race, and Race, a wily ring veteran, as we said before, knows the rules and knows the break right at that four count.
A wrestling move. Biting, but that's the Animal. He's hungry. Oh, gosh.
And Race sends the Animal over the top rope, but the Animal drags the King right out on the floor with him. And George Steele looked as if he was going to ram the King into the timekeeper's table, but Harley, pardon the pun, turned the tables on the Animal.
Yeah, turn the tables and use it on his head. Oh, and look at this. The chair. I'm safer here. I like this job better than being where they are right now, or the referees, to tell you that.
Yes, indeed. The Animal now with the steel chair trying to even the score with the King, Harley Race.
Oh, my, Bruce, look.
Hercules in from behind, attacking the Animal, George Steele, and it's a two-on-one situation, not good for the Animal.
I wonder if that was a tactic of Mr. Heenan to send part of the other family member in to help. Oh,
they very well be. Right now, Cowboy Scott Casey coming down for the
rescue. Look at this, Bruce.
Leaping Lanny Poffo and the King, Harley Race and Hercules. Dispose of Casey and Poffo immediately. And once again, two on one.
Absolutely, and the crowd is standing here. I stand. I can't see, but they are really into this match.
The passing crowd. And now the Young Stallions. Paul Roman, Jim Powers going to work on Hercules and the King. There you see Jim Powers going to work on Harley Race and King Kong on the enters.
If they're not careful, Bundy will make geldings out of these guys.
Indeed, Bobby Heenan and the Heenan family now. Heading for higher ground.
Going home to Dad, I'm sure.
Bobby Heenan's master plan may not have worked.
The winner of this bout resulting from a disqualification, George the Animal Steel.
Hard-fought battle for the Animal.
The winner of the match, the Animal, George Steel.
Oh, no. Look, he's going, there it is. He was starting to eat on Harley's arm. He's going to go for it.
The customary ritual of the Animal, George Steel, as he tears up the top turnbuckle. See Bam Bam Bigelow and others who help clear the ring and help the Animal out in a very uneven situation. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. Bruce Pritchard and my men.
Let me introduce you to my guest, manager, mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. The reigning Intercontinental Champion, a Honky Tonk Man. Now, gentlemen, as I understand it, the reason we have you here is so that you can deliver on a promise, Honky Tonk Man. Last week, you said, and you would give us 10 reasons.
10 good reasons, man.
All right, 10 good reasons why you are the greatest Intercontinental Champ and much better than Randy Macho Man Savage ever was. Are you here to deliver?
Reason number one, not that it really matters, but I've become a big singing star now. I'm even a better singer than Elvis Presley was. I've got the number one hit song on a new wrestling album, Pile Driver, called Honky Tonk Man, and it's done by me. Reason number two, I have the best manager in the whole wide world. I've got a man for a manager. I've got the mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, the greatest manager of all time. And reason number three, not that.
I want to tell you something right now. You're looking at the greatest Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion of all time, yeah. And listen, Big Mouth, people with Big Mouth get themselves in big trouble. You want to wake up with a Macho Man just hangover? You keep doing the thing, and you'll find out why. Yeah.
Well, I've just been waiting on the day that I can wrestle you, Macho Man, because I don't think you're the greatest of all time.
Unbelievable. I don't even think you said what you said. But that's the thing right there. A challenge to the Macho Man, Randy Savage. What a people right here, Honky Tonk Man. So why don't we do the thing? And why don't we do the thing? Why don't we do the thing right now in that ring?
I think he's on his way to ring. He's out in the people. He's going right through the people. Savage, is he hot or what? Look at this. He wants the Honky Tonk Man. He wants the Honky Tonk Man right now.
Well, this is totally ridiculous. There's no match that's been signed. There's no money that's been talked about.
What's the story? He is
a challenge. What? I'd love to get in the ring with him right now, but I'm not dressed for it. I'm not dressed for this one.
Well, a challenge position. We will see what will happen.
Honky Tonk Man not dressed for the match. We'll be back as we continue with more. That can mean only one thing.
About
the Islanders.
The ring area.
led by manager Bobby the Brain Heenan, from the South Pacific, at a total combined weight of 507 pounds, here are Haku and Tama, the Islander.
Oh yeah, that's up.
Their opponents, at a total combined weight of 438 pounds, introducing from Texas, Jim Evans. His partner from Seattle, Washington, Brady Boone.
All right, Boone and Evans teaming up, I believe, for the very first time, and they're going to need Lady Luck riding on their shoulders.
Oh, definitely. You know, the Islanders, they were a good tag team. Now they are a great tag team. The addition of Bobby Heenan has changed this team, made them definite top contenders here in the World Wrestling Federation.
They are the top contenders indeed. The speed merchant in there, Mr. Agility, this man is tough as well. Referring to, of course, Tama. His partner, Haku, waiting on the outside. Ooh. Yes. Over. Right back out of now. Ooh!
Oh!
My goodness! What a clothesline!
You know, nobody gives these guys credit for the great wrestling ability they have, either.
That's not a bad point, Jesse. Ooh, but look at that! Every now and then they get a little overconfident.
That's all right. Better to be overconfident than underconfident.
I think we've always said that they were great wrestlers. What we object to is the new tactics that they're using since they come under Bobby Heenan. That's
why do you object? Because they're on a long
winning
streak.
Because they don't need them. They were winners to start off with. Now they are so vicious and so unnecessary because they could be winners just the same.
Yeah, but I think they get more enjoyment out of this style. They're happier men. I notice they walk around with smiles on their faces now.
Well, maybe because Heenan did a good job in distorting their minds, their brains.
Big Haku tagging Tama back in now. Tama coming in via the top rope. Oh, wow. Down across the top of the head.
And I love the trunks.
You do, huh?
Look at this. Look at that. Now that's confidence. When you can walk in and paintbrush somebody.
That's arrogance. That's not confidence. That's arrogance. Elbows rugging the shoulder, spinning Jim Evans down to the canvas. The tag is made now.
He paintbrushed him with an elbow right there.
Ooh.
And I love Haku, the power man on this team.
Oh,
look at that agility. Wow.
In total control at the moment, the Islanders. Back made, what's going to happen here? Haku holding Jim Evans. From the top rope, Tama! Swing shot down to the canvas.
He can get the three count right now, I think, if he wants it, but he don't want it yet.
Oh, this Evans is really in bad shape. They have just kicked him from pillar to post. It's like a limp dish rag in there. Driving right up into the back. Now the Islanders are just having fun in there. Oh,
man. Teamwork, Bruno.
Teamwork, huh?
That's what you called it earlier when Powers interfered.
Here are your winners, the Islanders.
Islanders victorious. And we'll take you now back to the replay.
Gentlemen, don't be surprised if we don't see Evans around for a while. What a terrible shellacking. And look at this double headbutt. I mean, they must have shot up 6 feet in the air coming down with those hard heads of theirs. And Evans is definitely hurt.
Wait a minute. Wait, let's come back to live action. Let's come back to action right now. What is going on? Them over
They're
here.
Coming out for a curtain call. Everybody loved them so much. Whoa, that's Chico.
Wait a minute.
This is getting interesting.
watching this. Just hammering, beating Tito Santana. Oh, wow. Security trying to get control here. We'll try and get some order.
Well, I'll tell you something. In my opinion, if you watch that Chico threw the first punch, they came out to talk to Santana.
We'll be
and
back.
He threw the first punch.
We'll
he
be right back.
Billy Graham and his tag team partner from Krakow, Poland, Polish Power, Ivan Putski. And their opponent, at a combined weight of 533 pounds, from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, Rocky Stone. And his tag team partner from Miami, Florida, Joe Mirko.
Talk about two super heavyweights, two powerhouses, Ivan Putski teaming up with superstar Billy Graham. Look out! Oh, an attack was about to be made by Murdo and his partner, Rocky Stone. They both got caught in bear hugs. This one could be over right now.
Why don't the referee get him out of the ring? Only two men can be in there.
Well, there's four guys in there right now as they were attacked. The bear hug, Ivan squeezing with it, and those, oh, there's the bell.
Is that it? That starts the match or is it over?
I believe the bell already rang to start the match. I'm sure that will end it.
I'm going to check on this.
We could have a record here. We could have a record in the making.
Here are your winners. The team of Polish Power, ladies and gentlemen. Superstar Billy Graham.
Well, that one made it out in the record books, but the WWF is one of the fastest tag team matches in history. And superstar Billy Graham and the Polish Power Ivan Putski were about to be matched up, and they just turned around and slapped two bear hugs, two matching ones, on their opponents and literally put them away. Right now, let's go to another one of our colleagues, Gretchen Gordon.
Introduce you to my guest at this time. Come on up here, Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
It means fire up. It means toughen up. It means go get them. That's what it's all about. Power!
All right, speaking of what it's all about, what's the business with this 2x4, or should I call it a 2x6?
2x4, baby. There's a lot of fancy Dan guys in this WWF, but Hacksaw Jim Duggan, I'm a meat and potato man, and a 2x4 is all I need to equalize things out.
Introducing first in the corner to my left, from Dublin, Ireland, weighing 161 pounds, Velvet McIntyre. And her opponent, from New Orleans, Louisiana, weighing 140 pounds, the World Wrestling Federation Ladies Champion, since sensational Sherry.
Beautiful, isn't she, Monsoon? Sensational Sherry? She is rather stunning, isn't she? Very attractive. Could be a centerfold, you know.
Well, I mean, you wouldn't be trying to get someone with a already with a championship belt into your family, would you?
Are you trying to say I would try to buy a championship?
Right. You know, if the shoe fits, you know, put it on.
You know, you can lead a horse to water.
Yeah, but you can't make a duck out of it. You know that. Something like that. Tremendous opportunity for Velvet McIntyre, even though this is a non-title matchup. Should she be victorious, it would make her the number one contender for a shot at the title.
Oh, any time.
Off lands one, right in the lower abdomen area. Velvet never ceases to amaze her how she can get in there and do all those moves barefooted.
Well, you see, in Ireland, most of the women are barefoot all the time. You know why that is?
That's number one. That's not true, but go ahead anyway.
Well, I don't know either. I've never been.
No,
I wouldn't care to be there.
You made it up. Go ahead.
I didn't. You think I just sit here and make things up?
Sure. You've never been in Beverly Hills in your life. Are you kidding?
You ask Oakland. He's been to my estate, John.
Sure. Tide has turned already in this matchup.
You know, I have a neighbor down the road. Yeah. Ted DiBiase, the million dollar man, just bought quite a palatial estate.
Bel Air, I understand.
Bel Air, yes. He's renting it.
He's renting it.
He moves around. When it gets cold, he moves.
How can you just pick up like that whenever you feel like it and just make a move?
Well, to explain it to the average humanoid, you can't, because they've usually stuck in the mud the rest of their lives wherever they live or wherever they were born.
Well, for him, it's no problem with his millions, I guess. Disgusting individual.
I think this Sensational Sherry is going to be a greater champion than Moore was.
Well, Sensational Sherry, you know, you are on the cover of the latest magazine, Jerry. But there's other interesting things inside. You have not got by the cover yet, I guess. There's a heck of an article in there about the ladies' champion. Sensational Sherry. You wouldn't know.
I never looked inside.
No, you never got by the top, the front, the first page.
Well, I'm on the cover.
Yeah, I know, but there's other, just, you know, never judge a book by its cover. There's some good stuff inside.
Well, I didn't read it.
No, I guess not. Oh, look at this beautiful maneuver. Standing, a head scissors, drop kick. Another beautiful move from a standing position. Could be all over here. Could have went for a reverse half Nelson there and didn't. Put in the ropes as referee Joe Morella points that out.
He's good at counting the two, Morella.
He counts the three.
Yeah, but he hasn't guts enough. I don't want to talk about it.
You want to start talk about that? I'm willing to venture into that vein if you want to get into how some of your people were humiliated at last WrestleMania. You want to talk about that?
No, I don't.
Oh.
You know, Sensational Sherry beat probably the toughest woman in sports, the fabulous Moolah.
No question about that.
And it wasn't a fluke. He pinned her right in the middle of that ring.
I was right there in the Sam Houston Coliseum. What are we going to have here? A giant swing, perhaps? Taking for a ride, here it comes. Boy, we can have a big upset in the making here. Beautiful giant swing. Velvet's a little bit dizzy too, though.
Didn't you used to do that when you were?
I certainly did. That was my favorite hold. One, two, no. Put on the rope again. I went around and made sure you were dizzy. I went around at least 25 or 30 times.
25 or 30 times?
Yeah.
That explains it.
Well,
nothing.
Well. Put her head down. Got away with it. Velvet committed a cardinal sin there and survived. Beautiful reverse roll up. Oh, no, look at the tights. Oh, I'm sure. Oh, look. Stole it. Stole the victory from Velvet. Use one of your favorite maneuvers.
She won.
The winner of this bout, the World Wrestling Federation Ladies Champion, Sensational Sherry.
Sensational Sherry, victorious here this week. Oh, Velvet doesn't like it. I don't blame her. Well, look at, she's going to work on it.
Velvet should be suspended and fined, barred, and put on probation.
Just like the one-man game.
Well, if you're going to do it to him, you can do it to her.
This match is over. The referee letting it continue on. There can be no change in the decision. But she's getting some satisfaction. Oh, right over the top rope. And down to the concrete goes the champion. She doesn't look like a champion right now, does she?
I'd like to be married to her and forget to bring home the egg.
Wow. She's devastated.
She's got the belt. Sensational Shirley has the title in her hand. Still the champion.
Well, there's no question. There was a non-title match to begin with, but she was victorious. Let's go back and take a look at how she, in fact, got the victory, which to me was not close. Look at that. Right there. Deep into the wrestling gear of Velvet McIntyre goes the champion to get the victory. Right now, let's catch up on some news about the WWF.